Thank you for being here. And thank you for those online. And let's see, let's get started. If I can remember my training. We have nothing to disclose. Oh, except Julia. Okay, I can follow instructions more or less. Here we go. So my first talk is on kind of an overview of health equity. So this is our simple objective. At the end of this session, I would like you all to go home and consider some actions you can take to reduce health disparities. And this is kind of similar to what our opening speaker did. This is an exercise called square breathing. So let's just do this anyways. For those in the audience, what you can do is sit at the edge of your seat as if you were a small child about to receive a present. Just imagine you're a small child. And then when you do meditation, this will tie into the wellness thing in a few days. Or maybe we're even doing more wellness than the wellness folks at this point. You can sit up straight with dignity. Sit up straight with dignity, your spine straight. And then follow this. We hold your breath for 4 seconds. You breathe in for 4 seconds. Hold. Breathe out. Hold. Breathe in. You can do that at work, and it's a good way to kind of reset before, example, if you do procedures, before you start a procedure, before you start a meeting. It's called square breathing, box breathing, and the reason I have that logo there is I first learned about it from, it's a trick they teach the firefighters. So if you think we have stress, firefighters have stress, and this is what they do. So this is a pro tip from a New York City Fire Department. Okay, the brief introductions. Faisal, Khosa is one of our first speakers, and he wrote this article amongst many of his other articles, and has done amazing work. He has the, amongst other things, ACR Humanitarian Award. So we have really an all-star. I'm blessed to have an all-star group here with me. Efren and Dan, I'm doing the MGH folks together, have, amongst other things, written this article on RAD Translate and just ways to mitigate or improve equity at Mass General. Julia Schoen is a resident at Wake Forest and is going to talk to us about a very important intersectional aspect of equity, the climate change. And Steve Waite is a lead author on this wonderful review in radiology. Okay, disclosure of commercial interest. My wife works for Pfizer. My daughter is a CEO of Satipads. I'm also liaison to the Health Equity Coalition, so you could say I'm biased toward health equity. I'm on the ACR Council Steering Committee for whatever that's worth. I'd like to shout out one of my colleagues, Carolyn De Benedictus, who is now in Disneyland with her family because this is spring break, apparently. But she wrote this nice review of health disparities within JACR. So lots of reading assignments if you haven't seen them already. And so in brief, this is one of the documents that or one of the publications that documents health disparities, right? Institute of Medicine in 2003 says disparities exist, racial, ethnic disparities in healthcare. And perhaps more recently, we have more incentive to address disparities because the Joint Commission has given you'll be judged on the way your institution addresses disparities. So perhaps that might get, for whatever project you come up with, the Joint Commission, you can use the Joint Commission mandate to support whatever project you want to do. Joint Commission just points out some disparities. Black women have 4 times more mortality for maternal mortality. Hispanic women are more likely to die from cervical cancer. Asian Americans are more likely to die from hepatitis. Diabetes rates are 30% higher than amongst Native Americans and Latinos than amongst whites. So some, one of the ways to mitigate disparities from the Institute of Medicine, as you may know, is to have a diverse workforce, right? And so in like a year or so after that first publication, they came out with a publication saying that a diverse healthcare workforce can help mitigate disparities. And in some lingo, that's so-called if you have a workforce that's concordant with the population, that can help mitigate disparities. And certainly, you know, if you give more culturally competent care, that can help, but it's certainly not the only thing. And by the time we have a concordant workplace, it's gonna be a long time. And so we have to figure out ways to mitigate disparities in addition to having a diverse healthcare workforce. I think this is essentially what I was just saying, and concordant workforce can mitigate disparities, but my pitch is that we need coalition before concordance. In other words, all of us have to kind of think together and figure out ways to correct disparities. Speaking about coalitions, there's Radiology Health Equity Coalition. They kind of go over some of the disparities on their website. So just an overview. They talk about rural health. Life expectancy is 3 years shorter for those in rural areas. 22% of those who live in rural areas, have higher mortality. I was just actually speaking to a local a person, and one of his jobs was to actually fly people from other islands in Hawaii to Oahu for presumably advanced imaging. And that was within the last 10 years. African-American, one of the disparities, again, women are more likely to die from breast cancer. Men are more likely to die from colorectal cancer, and Black Americans with diabetes are 3 times more likely to have a limb amputated than others. More Hispanic disparities, Latinos more likely to die from colorectal cancer. AAPI, more likely to die from stomach cancer. And again, hepatitis and TB. There's one interesting study that in New York City, NYU, they have a screening study because Asian American women get non-squamous cell lung cancer that is not picked up by traditional screening. And so they're trying to figure out if there should be additional criteria for lung cancer screening. So, you know, these are kind of some of the suggested ways we mitigate disparities, whether it's education, and outreach, and cultural competency. These are one of Carolyn's slides from her version of this talk. These are some concrete things. If your residents have a RAD-AID chapter, support RAD-AID chapter, this would do something regarding international disparities. And afterwards, you can talk to Faisal to see what he's done to mitigate disparities. And so without further ado, let's Let's hear from our, learn from our speakers. And oh, one shout out, there's another session on research led by Dr. Carlos this afternoon. So mark your calendars and thank you. I'll tee up the next one. Okay, Dr. Khosa, thank you.
Thank you so much. So at the start, you know, my talk is about gender disparity in patents, clinical trials, and grants. How many in the audience have a female or a minority department chair? How many in the panel have a female or a minority department chair? So let's start with that. Here are my disclosures. Objectives of the talk are gender disparity in patents, in clinical trials, grants, and I'll touch upon benefits of diversity. Nolan gave me a great start and set up. Essentials, existential gender disparity. The reason I'm going to talk about gender disparity primarily is because race in clinical trials is not recorded. Race in NIH grants is not recorded. So race, unfortunately, is not recorded, which is, I don't understand that, because for most applications that we fill, there is a section whether you want to declare it or not. You know, you are a minority, you're Asian, you're Southeast Asian, you're South Asian, you're, you know, which descent or origin you are, you've got a choice, but there's work to be done, I guess, in patents and grants. We've documented gender disparity in academic disciplines. We've shown it in professional society leadership. We've shown it in professional society awards. We've shown it in editorial boards of journals. Those are all published manuscripts that my team fortunately did. And there is no recourse in sight. So I would be... It would be great if I could say that in my career or lifetime, I'll see the promised land. It's a mountain that I'm climbing. I don't know when the mountain, I'll reach the summit, and I don't know if there is a promised land. It is a hope and sincere. It's Martin Luther King's dream, to say the least. Let's look at this video, and then I'll request the audience, somebody to take the mic and tell us what they see.
Okay, Noel, you try now. Come to your honor. Too black, bro.
Too black.
Yeah?
What are you
doing? Come again. Come again, Sash. Whoa. Too black.
What I have to do is to get.
What do you have to do?
This is how racialist thing is.
Yeah.
I have to use that piece of white. Is that napkin?
Ah, sure again.
Napkin again.
Right, bring
what's
up.
What's it called on a hand?
So what do we think we saw? Anybody in the audience? Please, volunteer. Thank you. Yeah, thank you so much. Yes, bias soap dispenser, but if you zoom out and have a bird's eye view, just imagine in the middle of pandemic, it was mandatory, right? The soap dispensers or the sanitizer dispensers, using them was mandatory to reduce the spread of pandemic. And if dispensers were not dispensing to people of color like me, I would be a vector for the infection. So we forget why equity, diversity, inclusion is so important. A picture is worth a thousand words, and this is what demonstrates. The other thing, if you look at automotive industry, and fortunately I've done that, I've cross-pollinated with engineering and business and other academic disciplines where there is talk about racial and gender inequality. If you look at the outcomes from motor vehicle accidents, at the same speed, on the same road, using the same vehicle, women have worse outcomes. And the reason for that is because all the mannequins that the trials are done on are male mannequins. So the shoulder width, the height, the general, phenotype is male. So women have worse outcomes because of that. And that was documented and published in engineering. Similarly, in business schools, it has been documented. And we all know, if I don't see it, how do I know I can be it? If you don't have a role model, and if you don't have somebody to look up to, you can't even dream of aspiring for a leadership position or a leadership role. I'll come back to this. I try and mix a bit of philosophy in my talks because otherwise it becomes mundane and boring. So what we do is, you know, all my research or most of it is from publicly available data. So a minority high school student, undergrad student, or a medical student anywhere in the world who's interested can collect the data in the comfort of their home. And it became more important during the pandemic for obvious reasons that you couldn't collect or compile data on patients and coming in the hospitals unnecessarily was prohibited. So publicly available data, we looked at the Canadian Intellectual Property Office data and United States Patent and Trademark Office data. Patents, we looked at the ones that were filed and we looked at the ones that were granted. Then we used Genderize a software, and I've published several on that, on racial disparity software and gender disparity. So we use that to determine or confirm that it was, you know, female gender or male gender. Let's look at gender disparity in Canada over 5 years. You can see the filed and you can see the granted from 2015 to 2019. And you can see that women were always 9% or 8%, never more, over that 5 years. And it was always males. And unfortunately, as I said, we cannot get more granular than that. Gender, of course, is on a spectrum, but that data is not recorded, and race is also not recorded. Let's talk about US now. Granted, filed and granted, again, it was between 8 and 10% maximum that women were, women filed and granted. And let me add to that, women, it has been 30 years now. So 1992 was the first class in which women were equal or more than men in medical school. 1992 was the first class. So it has been 30 years. So the excuse that these things take time, I'm often told by leadership, these things take time. And my answer or response is the recorded history of the world is 6,000 years. How much more do you expect us to wait? And the follow-up question is, whose time, your time or my time? Because it's different. It's completely two separate time zones that we are talking about. So are you going to come down to my time zone or should I go to your time zone like Star Trek they used to transfer people? Remember, the person would go into that elevator, disappear and reappear somewhere else? So is it going to be your time or is it going to be my time? I at least need to know what the rules of the game are and how the chessboard is set up. Let's go to patents now. Again, 2015 to 2019, and it was publicly available data. All my projects have majority, you know, women and minorities as co-authors, and they are medical students, high school, undergrad students. So, you know, a percentage of male inventors, as I said, range from 90 to 93. And, you know, in US and Canada, it was the same. This underrepresentation of female inventors in device patenting represents significant gender disparity. And nobody would disagree with that. You know, it's not 60 and 40. It's 10 and 90. Let's talk about NIH radiology funding. Again, publicly available data, 2016 to 2019. NIH research portfolio online reporting tools were assessed or looked upon. PI information was collected from Scopus, from department websites, from LinkedIn and Doximity. No ethical approval or IRB was required. If you look at number of PIs, male are 460, female are 117. And this is a published paper. So, you know, we looked at MD, PhD combined degrees, again, 53 versus 19, 350, 93. And so we are nowhere close. And if you look at the total amount, look at the disparity, glaring disparity. So then, you know, I've had this argument when I presented it at different forums that if women don't apply how can we give them the grants? Or if women don't submit patents, how can we approve it for them? Well, why don't we provide them the opportunities and the tools? If they are 55 or 58 now percent of the class in every medical school, in North America at least, should we not do something to get parity? Whose responsibility is it? It has to be the leader, right? If you are a true leader, then you will treat somebody, everybody, equitably, equally. Same start line is actually setting them up for disparity and failure. It can never be the same start line. And this is what I emphasize in my research as well. The focus has to be on the finish line. How do we get everybody across the finish line? So a total of 2,064 grants were given out. 16, 70, 81% almost, I'm talking about round figures, were to male PIs, and less than 20% were for female PIs. Let's talk about clinical trials. We studied 1990 to 2017. That's enough longitudinal duration. We studied all, again, publicly available data, identified all FDA-licensed contrast media, and we looked at the NIH website, clinicaltrials.gov, data collection, country of study, phase of trial, study randomization, male versus female participation. I'll not go into that granular detail. That will be published soon. It's being written up, the manuscript. 64 studies were identified. 43 had more males than females. 43. You saw the dispenser, right? And I just told you about the car accident outcomes. So in 43 trials, you had more males than females. Now, if the same medication that was tried upon all males is given to a female of color, there will be more reactions. There will be more adverse outcomes. But the problem there is, why do women and minorities don't recruit or don't opt for these trials? Because the gentleman recruiting, or PI as I showed, is of not of their demographic. There is no concordance there. So there is sometimes actually a trust deficit. That is why minorities and women don't opt for clinical trials. So then again, the responsibility or onus is not on the minorities or women, which is very easily said and placed. The blame is placed on them. No. And until and unless we get that right, we won't have culturally competent care or provision of it. This is some granular detail. I'll not go into that, but let's go on to benefits of increasing diversity in teams. So there is benefit for every stakeholder. When you look at trainees, they have role models. If you have a workforce that is diverse, they have role models. They have sponsors, they have mentors that they can identify with. For workforce, there is decreased burnout and increased productivity the more diversity you have in the workforce. And in the patients, there is provision of culturally competent care and therefore improved outcomes. So it is a win-win for everyone in the healthcare system. And the bane of existence of our profession is the patient. The patient is at the epicenter. Nobody else is at the epicenter. It's not a physician, it's not a trainee, it's not a nurse practitioner. The patient is the epicenter. That is why we exist. And if patient outcomes are documented to improve and patient experience is enhanced with increasing diversity, why would somebody in their sane mind resist or not support equity, diversity, and inclusion? Objectives of the talk again were gender disparity in patents, clinical trials, grants, and benefits of diversity. Thank you so much for your patience and your participation. God bless you all. Stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you, Faisal. Next up, Dr. Efren Flores. We're so organized, I think we're going down.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. And thank you, Nolan, for preparing getting us together for this session, for the kind introduction and I'm here to follow this incredible presentation. And one of the things that Nolan mentioned was to make the topic or the presentation just to talk about how we can do the advancing health equity in a practical way. So that was going to be our focus for the morning today. So these are my disclosures. So when we think about justice, equity, diversity, and inclusion, or JEDI, when we think about diversity, equity, and inclusion work, many times tend to be working in silos. And the important thing is that all of them are working towards advancing the ultimate goal, which is social justice. But we need to break those silos and really working together to achieving that goal. And in order for us to do that, the first thing that we should take into consideration is that health equity is intrinsically intersectional. So all the factors outside, inside, from the patient, out and surrounding the patient's community and the healthcare system, all of them merge at the patient level and impact how patients navigate our health system, particularly in radiology. So we think about how health equity work is intrinsically intersectional, then we have to think about the role of intersectionality in terms of health equity work and how all these factors from gender to education to all external factors outside of the patient not only influence their care, but also how they continue to evolve along their life journey. So it's not a static process, it continues. So our process or our care should reflect a continued evolution of our patients as well. And that would allow us to move from equality to equity. And we think about this graph from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, where they have the patient going through the crosswalk and how everybody gets something different. So one size does not fit all, because all these social determinants of health impact patients differently. So for some patients, some of the factors like economic stability, education, may be protective, like in the figure from the pandemic, and in other patients may increase their vulnerability to having either worse outcomes to COVID or other worse outcomes or increasing gaps in care. So when we think about how social determinants of health impact everyone differently, then we have to think about how the factors, all the factors influence the entire cycle of radiology care. And so even though we may develop programs or interventions, we have to understand that they may not benefit every single patient, even patients from the same community, or may share a similar background or different preferred language. Those interventions need to be really tailored to the specific needs of the patient, taking into consideration the role of intersectionality. So what can we do? So the first thing is then we have to, as a field in radiology and frankly in healthcare in general, we have to commit to dismantling structural barriers or structural racism. So in a paper published recently in academic radiology by one of our colleagues, Peter Abraham, we were talking about different specific areas where we can talk about dismantling racism, such as education through an anti-racism journal club, through recruitment, so workforce development. And then when we think about performance measures, like not only update departmental institutional policy, but also develop like metrics that are allowing us to evaluate the process effectively and systematically in order to achieve our goal of decreasing disparity. And when we're developing interventions, we should also focus on developing program or intervention that are benefiting patients outside of the healthcare system as well. So for example, when we think about the digital divide, if we provide a digital access coordinator or a navigator, or a digital navigator, that will help patients connect to the patient gateway and navigate our healthcare system, we also have to think that learning that increasing digital literacy will also benefit the patient's life outside the system, because these factors don't go away. As we see in this graph, these factors affect patients through the entire life. So the way, if we are able to move upstream and develop programs or intervention that can assist patients along that journey, then not only we're improving their health care delivery, but also we're improving their overall health and livelihood. So how do we do this? And how do we think about developing programs and intervention outside and moving upstream? So working in developing infusing health equity into our work should not be like a separate checklist. It should be really into every single aspect that we do. And we can use our pillars, the pillars that we have in our department. So for example, research, clinical education, and innovation, and think through health equity component, but more so infusing empathy in that work, because that allows us to then rethink how these pillars in radiology look like, and then our care can really be tailored to improve, um, to better provide care for the diverse patient population that we serve, regardless of the specific needs that they need or the specific area that we're interested in. So let's talk about, for example, when we think about education and we think about race-based medical education really perpetuating health disparities. So when we think about from the research that is race-based with no clear scientific background, and then that goes into our medical education, then goes into clinical practice, and what it does is that it perpetuates disparities because it influences how we deliver care. However, we have to move away from that and really think about race-conscious medicine, where we understand that race is a social construct, and then understand the gaps and how the factors are affecting our patients, and then not think that race predetermines patient outcome, but more so is a proxy for all the factors that are outside of the healthcare system that influence care, and how we really then we can have a better, clear idea of how to decrease disparity for our patients that are not solely based on race. So we talk about also how we improve our clinical care. So we talked earlier about cultural competency, which is the ability to work with people from diverse backgrounds and serve patients. But we also have been discussing cultural humility, which is recognizing our own limitations. But then also there's a lot of ongoing discussion and moving towards cultural dexterity, which is using emotional intelligence and understanding how do we adapt our social cultural awareness to really understand how these factors change over time, and how do we continuously improve our processes. So for example, American surgical departments are doing a lot of work on cultural dexterity using the framework about that you have to continue to keep up with your surgical skills in the same way you should be keeping up with your with cultural dexterity, because they will allow you to continue to be able to adapt your care to the continuously changing needs of your patient population. Then we also have to think about justice-oriented innovation and how this is a process that needs to be intentional. So there's discussion, for example, a digital redlining where you have two households like less than 1 mile apart with different internet access, and even though they're paying the same price, there's the only difference is like one in predominantly higher median household income, predominantly higher white patient compared to the other household. And then you think about how this impacts patients' usage of telehealth. But also, this is not limited to internet access or primary care telehealth services. We can also see in this paper published in collaboration with our colleague, Dr. Narayan, who is in the audience, talking about the digital divide in radiology and how accessing care or telehealth services impacts the patient engagement with screening mammography, which is an area directly impacting our care in radiology. But also when we think about the intentionality of that process, we have to think about an intervention that leverage the benefits of technology and the ability of technology remaining nimble to adapt to the patient's need. And then that's how RAD Translating, collaboration with my colleague Dan Chonde, was born. And then one of the work streams in RAD Translating is in screening mammography. So understanding the global component or the community component, seeing how this is impacting radiology specific, and then you can develop a program or an intervention that will help patients with specific need. In this case, could be with screening mammography, although RAD Translating was developed initially for COVID, now it's evolving to different area. But then you can see how this program can be scaled to improve the delivery of our care in different areas and also improve the livelihood of our patients. So we also have to think about how inclusive research leads to better care and better outcomes. So the more inclusive your research, the more representative of your results are going to be, but also the more generalizable as well. But then Dr. Gilmore Bykovsky talks about model that talks about the participant relationship center research engagement model, where they talk about different steps here from relationship being bidirectional to inclusive research design that plays attention to underserved group, but also accessibility and fit to ensure that maximum participation and the research fits the capacity of our patient population. Also openness, which is what you want, is the research component to the participant to remain open to participate, and then readiness to engage. But one of the things that they emphasize here that these stages are not mutually exclusive and they don't have to be sequential. So things can be can happen in different stages. The most important thing is that you have a sustained investment and a sustained relationship. So it not only becomes something about doing your research and then not being engaged in the community, because we want to avoid health equity tourism, like my colleague Dr. Neil talks about, but more so you want to like develop programs, share the results with the community, engage with the community in a long-term process. Because inclusive research is community-led here in the event that we had in Scope HQ, led by Cindy Dix, who is a collaborator from the People's Heart with Dan, myself, and others. And we can see here a participation on a place that is a mix of a community apparel and community art. And you see in the front, you don't see like us discussing the research or any particular or leading the discussion. We see the community really leading the discussion, because that to me is what it allows us to build trust. And trust and credibility take time. So that engagement, you can see the room was full here, out there in the corner, my colleague Marsushi as well, and others. And but that community engagement, it's not only for a specific event, it continues. So we'll see here with Java with Jimmy and Dudley Square, we'll see at the Puerto Rican event, we're also back at Scope HQ with Artivism program. So that then we can have some relationship that are not transactional, and really become more of a partnership with the community. And if we have a research program that they would like to participate, sure, but like it doesn't, it the outcome is not what drives the relationship, it's really the journey. Because health equity is a catalyst for organizational change, so you shouldn't see it as a different thing that you have to do. It's the right thing to do, and it's allowing us to truly deliver precision medicine, because precision medicine starts with engaging patients. So what can we do to achieve the organizational change? We can leverage the CMS strategic pillars to talk about advancing equity, expanding access, engaging patients, driving innovation, protect programs, and foster excellence. So if we look at the advancing health equity program, they have five different priorities. It's from expanding the collection of data that reflects our diverse community, to identifying disparities, to building capacity, and then advancing language, and then increasing all forms of accessibility. But we shouldn't see the reason why they don't put in different pillars is because this process is sequential. So we use the framework for health research disparity of detecting, understanding, reducing, and evaluating. And we have to think about this process, a continuous process, when in the discovery phase, you'll find new gaps, you develop a program, you improve care, then you go back and measure, and then you'll find different gaps, or because your patient population will continuously evolve, so this cycle becomes continuous. But then in that journey, you will be improving the life of many of patients in your community, and it's the right thing to do, because our goal is really to build a better future together. So when we think about, you know, our comfort zone, it tends to be like our daily basis, like what we do every day, going to our work stream, how going to the routine, it's simpler, easier. Nobody likes change, but truly when we think about change, it's where growth happens, and this is what it will allow us. Growing and moving toward that steps toward health equity and achieving the ultimate goal of social justice. Thank you.
Efren, thank you so much. Next up, Dan Chonde.
All right. Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me. This is my talk, Barriers to Equitable Patient-Centered Care. No disclosures, but I do like to have a little land acknowledgement. I live in practice in the city of Boston, territory of Massachusetts, Pawtuck, and the neighbors of the Wittapog, Nipmuc peoples, who stewarded the land for hundreds of generations. We recognize the repeated violations of their sovereignty, territory, and water perpetuated by invaders that have impacted the original inhabitants of that land for 400 years. So I want to talk to you about barriers to care, right? The way I'm going to split up this talk is a 1-minute primer on the social determinants of health,
It's not even really a primer. I'm just going to say it, and you'll just look at it somewhere else. Then I'm going to model barriers to care, and then we'll talk about physical, institutional, and sociocognitive. So I always like to discuss this with people. You know, in quality and safety, we talk about having a preoccupation with safety, and, you know, no one hates their quality and safety officer, right? We understand quality and safety is important. We always want to be doing better. We're just like quality and safety folks, but we have a preoccupation with inequity, right? You're never going to run into a system where they say, well, it's safe enough. We're done. We're done with quality and safety, right? You're continuously improving. No matter how good our system is, there's always going to be equity folks saying, we can do better. Let's evaluate the system. Let's, you know, test the limits of this infrastructure. Let's find the cracks and let's fix those cracks. So, you know, DE&I, you should never feel bad about bringing up DE&I stuff. If someone is saying, like, we're done, that's past, we have it good enough, you can always say, no, 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 there's always something more to be done, and you should never feel guilty about pushing for it. I got this slide from Efren because I could not remember for the life of me where this imaging plot was. But this is kind of the work stream from the patient in the top left corner as they get the referral all the way to having the images read and then follow-up care, right? This is the patient journey in radiology. But we need to remember there's a whole bunch of stuff that happens before this, right? That's all the social determinants of health. Social determinants of health, this is the one-minute primer, by the way. It's who you are, what you do, and the conditions in which you live, grow, work, age, et cetera, right? It's more than just your genetics that make up your health. Your health is due to all these other things. And what are those other things? There's a lot of other things, right? And I don't have time in my 12-minute speaking with you to touch on all those things, but there's a great place that you can find it on YouTube. The Public Health Academy, which is a nonprofit out of Australia. They have a lovely little YouTube video. I think it's like 10, maybe 15 minutes. Let's Learn Public Health is part of that. It's part of that series. It talks all about the social determinants of health. After you watch it, you'll have a much better grounding for that than I can give you in a minute. So go out and look for that. Getting back to the patient journey, right? There's many steps along this way where barriers to care exist. Now, in the health equity literature, they've created this model for understanding health equity. This is the healthcare access barriers model. And keep in mind, like many models for things, it's not necessarily perfect. It was just, you know, theorized, developed by a number of people working together, in this instance, Carrillo et al. And they set it up into three higher level things, which were structural barriers, financial barriers, and cognitive barriers. Your structural barriers being your institutional barriers, like access to transportation, operating hours, et cetera. Financial, which is the cost. And then cognitive, which is knowledge and communication, availability of interpreters, et cetera. Personally, I find this more of like a institutional-centered model. So, you know, I like to think about things in a more patient-centered model. So it's going to be your physical barriers, your institutional barriers, and your sociocognitive barriers. Your physical barriers are, you know, what's limiting patient to getting to their appointment, right? How are all of those things complicated? Then there's your institutional barriers, and that's, you know, how do we organize healthcare as a society? That's, you know, fee-for-service would fit in that. The fact that we don't have universal health care would fit into that. The way in which hospitals kind of carve up their areas instead of having more soft lines fits into that. And the third thing is sociocognitive, mostly because it's the combination of the influence of society and the understanding of the individual on both their health and the role with health organizations play in it, versus calling it just cognitive, because that really feels a little demeaning towards patients. There's a clear intersection between how society deals with, you know, passing this information to patients and how patients interpret it. For instance, you know, where are you advertising? How are you advertising for certain care? Is that advertisement cross-culturally competent? It's our job as providers to ensure physical barriers, institutional barriers, and sociocognitive barriers are limited. It's not the patient's job. Now, just a little physical barriers focus, there's location versus distance to your care site. And these are things that we as our individual hospitals can address versus the institutional, which are more us as a society needs to address. So location, transportation access, operating hours, very easy for us to, you know, petition our chairs to work on changing operating hours. Waiting times, it's 2023. The fact that waiting times and scheduling systems are as archaic as they are is shocking to me. Interpreter access and reminders. So here's one example. This is actually a paper that Efren and Dr. Worms out of Pennsylvania, Philly, yeah, Penn worked on when she was in the area. And this is, you know, patient access to care using ride shares, right? Buses break down. In Massachusetts, the bus system is egregious, it's terrible, it's hard to get patients there on time, and it can lead to patients missing appointments. They worked on, you know, what if every patient who had a challenge was given a rideshare voucher to ensure they made their appointment? And this is our imaging center out in Chelsea, and you can see the patients that actually utilized this rideshare system are from all over Massachusetts. Now, here they showed that rideshare patients were more likely to be on time, and older, underemployed, and non-commercial insurance patients were more likely to use it, but that's kind of the limitations of that study. A similar study was performed in the radiation oncology space, and they were able to show that, you know, using this rideshare program ensured that patients finished their radiation therapies versus patients who didn't utilize the rideshare, and also it was able to facilitate $1.6 million in revenue, which far outweighed the cost of this program. So, you know, instituting rideshare actually was a pretty substantial moneymaker for that department. I know if I can bring in $1.6 million to my department, they will be very happy to see me. Similarly, with physical barriers, there's how late, how easy is it to access breast cancer imaging, right? Single center study, one urban breast imaging facility and two suburban satellites. You know, 9.6% of total screening and 2% of total diagnostic scans performed on Saturdays. So, you know, this, I would say 10% of all your screening to be performed on Saturdays. That's a pretty sizable amount considering that there's only 7 days in a week. Now, when you look at this, patients are 1.5 times more likely to be from racial and ethnic minorities, right? That's because we have limitations in, you know, based on society, how we can attend appointments, right? If you don't have childcare accessible, if you work during the day, you can't take days off. I mean, as a trainee, I can tell you trying to take a day off or an hour off for a dentist appointment is hard. Imagine if I was working at Kroger's. Right? Some of these things are just impossible. How do you fit in preventative care in that schedule? It just goes by the wayside. So patients were 1.1 times more likely to speak English as a second language. So you see, this is also language differences, right? So having more access, so longer hours, including weekends, right? This improves the experience for historically underserved populations. Now it also improves the experience of everyone, right? Because I can tell you there were also, if it's 1.5 times more likely, there's also a number of we could call them not historically underserved patients that were benefiting from this increased hours. So this limits physical barriers for our patients of interest, in this case being historically underserved populations, but also all patients in general. Now, finally, there's the physical barriers, mobile lung cancer screening, right? How cool is this? If you live hours away from your hospital, why bring Mohammed to the mountain when you can bring the mountain to Mohammed? In this case, you know, you can bring these to communities that are historically underserved and then create a space where they can actually engage with these systems. In this paper, it's really interesting. Obviously, all that information's at the bottom, how to find the paper, but they scheduled it in concordance with community health centers. So, you know, get the word out, get everyone interested in this, and they were able to work with patients. So when when the lung cancer screening truck was there, they could get those patients to get screened. Now, of course, this wasn't the scanner that was used, but Siemens now offers like a like almost a complete package product for this. So you can buy a mobile lung cancer screening vehicle with all the bells and whistles already there. Now, institutional barriers, we have our cost, we have the shared fragmentation of health information, the fact that we still use CDs, referral follow-up, who's following up on results, how do we access this information, right? These are things that us as a society or a healthcare, larger healthcare society need to say, you know, we need to fix this stuff. This is a paper looking at, you know, what if you just ditched the CD and you had some sort of system which allowed you to upload images across the United States. This was based on the University of Utah using a cloud-based digital imaging exchange software. And these are just some of the many sites that were able to upload their imaging for breast cancer screening. So instead of having to, you know, have the patient do all the work of collecting that information, or, you know, waiting weeks for them to send over a CT or a disc, you know, what if that could happen much faster? And this found reduced delays for outside imaging of nearly 50%. And, you know, from a climate change difference, imagine we're not printing those CTs, right? We're just sending ones and zeros over the ether. So, you know, and of course, this is also shown to be incredibly useful in emergency room settings where, you know, patients might not come with their prior outside imaging. Now, similarly, here's a paper looking at motion artifacts with expiratory phase scanning CT. Interestingly enough, this was ways in which to reduce motion. And what they found was videos helped patients reduce motion. Now, those videos have subtitles. They have language in it, right? And you can change the language to suit the person that you're teaching it to. So having cross-culturally competent videos, you can improve diagnostic accuracy of this imaging, right? There's papers out there that show that patients with limited English proficiency can have increased motion artifacts on abdominal MRI. Obviously, abdominal MRI, it's not going to be a one-minute imaging session like a CT scan. And you, when you're looking for something small, you need these patients to stay still. Coming up with very simple technologies and thinking on these technologies, how do we add a higher level of cross-cultural competency can really benefit all patients and benefit us as providers. In turn, it benefits our colleagues because we're able to, you know, detect the cancer as it's smaller. They're able to intervene when it's smaller. It's going to save extended ICU stays. It's going to save extended complicated therapies. Again, everyone benefits. So in conclusion, I want you all to embrace a preoccupation with inequity, right? If we're not always trying to look at how do we do things better, even when it's, you know, how do we come up with a new logo for our pencils that we're going to hand out, if we're not always thinking about equity, it's going to fall through the cracks, and our organizations and ourselves, we're going to stick our foot in our mouth, and no one likes the taste of their toes. Applying an overarching model can help organize barriers to care. Healthcare access barriers model, that's the common one. I personally suggest something a little more patient-centered. We'll see where that goes. And then consider barriers related to place or physical barriers, institution or systemic barriers, and then sociocognitive barriers. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dan. Next up is Dr. Julia Schoen, and I just wanted to clarify, I'm pretty sure Dan said no one likes the taste of their toes as opposed to Nolan likes the taste of their toes. But,
why don't you do it in your free time, though?
You be you.
Hi, my name is Julia Schoen. I'm a radiology resident at Wake Forest, and I'm really excited to talk to you today about the links between climate and health equity. I have no financial relationships related to the content of this presentation. I have two goals today. One is to teach you about the links between climate change and health equity, and then the second is to give you some tangible suggestions of what we can do about it as radiologists. So why, you're all very busy, you have a lot on your plates, why should you care about climate change? This is a figure from the most recent IPCC report that came out in March showing where we stand with climate change, and we're at a very unique point in human and geologic history. This is a convoluted figure, so I'm going to break it down for you guys a little bit more. So this first part, these color bars, show historical global average temperatures from the early 1900s until today. You can see that the average global surface temperature has risen about 1°C. And then the second part shows future climate scenarios based on our decisions and what the temperature may look like for future generations. The second part shows these color bars imposed on different generations. So if you think about my parents born in the 1950s, they've experienced about 1°C of temperature change in their lifetime. But if you think about my son born in 2021, his climate future is still unwritten, right? Our choices determine the future of our children and grandchildren. And children are a perfect example of who experiences climate inequity and who is vulnerable to climate change. So what is climate vulnerability? So we talk about climate vulnerability as who's going to be most exposed to climate change, often related to geographic or temporal factors. Then who is most sensitive to climate change? And this may be related to physiologic things like age or pre-existing conditions. And finally, who has the resources to adapt to climate change? So these three factors contribute to whether you're vulnerable to, particularly vulnerable to climate change. But what does this have to do with human health? Well, climate change is predicted to have a ton of impacts on human health. These are very wide-ranging. This figure from the World Health Organization shows that these range from morbidity and mortality related to extreme weather, respiratory diseases, changes in vector-borne diseases, or malnutrition related to agricultural insecurity. But I want to focus on these first three and put them into that climate vulnerability framework that I showed you earlier to see how these can exacerbate health inequities. So this first one, how does heat work to contribute to health inequities? So I told you that global temperature has risen by about 1°C. This doesn't happen equally, right? This happens more in urban areas than it does in grassy areas or areas near water bodies. And physiologically, we've all felt this, right? This is a picture of a Baltimore street on a summer day, and you can see how the temperature is different in where there are paved surfaces compared to the shaded areas. So who does this disproportionately affect? How many people in this room have heard of redlining before? So right, redlining is a historical policy, a federal policy that determined which neighborhoods would get mortgages in the 1930s, and these distinctions were often made on the basis of race. We see these distinctions today leading to disparities in healthcare access, but they also lead to disparities in temperature. On average, redlined neighborhoods are about 2.6 degrees hotter than their suburban counterparts, right? So this redline patient or populations in redline communities are going to experience the effects of a warming planet more than other populations. Often these are minority and low SES populations. Okay, so how do we adapt to hotter temperatures? If you live in a safe neighborhood, you might be able to open your window or you might turn on your air conditioner. But often in these redline communities, inefficient construction and higher electricity costs are going to make it harder for patients to air condition their homes. So now we come to our framework. We have an exposure that's increasing with climate change that disproportionately impacts urban areas. And then because of historical housing policies, this often tends to affect a minority and low SES populations who have fewer financial resources to adapt. All right, so I want to talk a little bit about respiratory illness, which is also increasing with climate change, right? Intuitively, as we burn fossil fuels, we're creating more air pollution, but also as the planet gets warmer, we're having longer allergy seasons that contribute to asthma and atopic conditions. And I'm going to talk about how children are particularly vulnerable to air pollution. So they're in a unique phase of organ development, and then because they intake air, more air per body weight, they get a higher dose of air pollution than adults do when they're exposed. When we come to our framework here, so we have an exposure, air pollution that's increasing with climate change, children are physiologically uniquely susceptible to this, and then policies traditionally have been effective at addressing air pollution, like the Clean Air Act, or locating schools further away from highways or industry, but children are not going to be people in the room to have conversations about these kinds of policies and implementation. And often these impact minority and low-income populations because industrial neighborhoods tend to be cheaper to live in. So then again, we have a group that has less say in how we adapt to air pollution and this exposure. Okay, so now I want to come to extreme weather. There are intuitive health impacts of extreme weather like hurricanes and wildfire, trauma during these events, and exposure to wildfire smoke, but also disruptions in care related to healthcare evacuations during these events can negatively impact patients. And finally, power outages also mean that patients who are dependent on medical devices or medications like insulin that need refrigeration can lead to worse outcomes during these kind of events. And we've seen that these events disproportionately impact the elderly or those with multiple chronic conditions. So in Hurricane Katrina, the majority of deaths were in the elderly population. And this is because these patients may have multiple illnesses and be less physiologically able to adapt to extreme weather. And then they may also be on multiple medications like beta blockers and anticholinergics that blunt their response to extreme stress. And then again, this is going to be a population with limited ability to adapt to these situations, right? They may have limited mobility or limited access to transportation, and then the elderly tend to have smaller social networks to help them out in these kind of situations. So when we come back to our framework again, we can see how the elderly are a particularly vulnerable population during extreme weather events. And so I've really only scratched the surface of the impacts of climate change on healthcare, but hopefully I've given you a framework to understand how these factors interact. Now I want to focus the rest of my talk on what we can do about it. And first, I'm going to talk a little bit about what we actually already have done about it, right? I don't think the lay press does a good job of emphasizing this, and I think it's important to know that we have made progress on climate change. So these are different climate emission scenarios. And this first one shows emission scenarios if we had no climate change policy. This orange bar is our current policies, what have resulted from international agreements like the Paris Agreement, and how we have managed to bring down future projected carbon emission scenarios. But then this blue line shows what countries have pledged to do, and the lower purple and green bars show the emission scenarios that we need to protect human health from the worst impacts of climate change. So you can see here that we have made a lot of progress, but we still have a long way to go. And this is called the implementation gap. So how can we address the implementation gap? Well, you may have heard a lot about individual actions you can do. So things like switching to a plant-based diet, switching to active transport like walking or biking, and switching to your power sourcing to renewable energies. And these are great actions, right? They have health benefits, whether it's having a healthier lifestyle or reducing pollution in your community. But they're also limited in their capacity to address this implementation gap. And you can get overwhelmed by trying to figure out how you can make all of these lifestyle changes. So I am so excited to be here talking to you guys today. But also when I was giving this opportunity, I felt pretty guilty, like, oh, I'm about to fly to Hawaii and emit a ton of carbon to ask people to join in on climate action, right? But individual actions can only get us so far, and we have to work together to change systems. And I think that as physicians, we have a unique ability to impact a pretty big system, and that's the healthcare system, right? So globally, healthcare is estimated to contribute about 4.4% of global carbon emissions. And in the US, we've supersized it, and we're accountable for over 25% of those carbon emissions, right? So 1% doesn't sound that big, but to put that into perspective, that's more emissions than the entire country of the UK. Okay, so what can we do about it in radiology? Well, I'm going to suggest three categories based on the data that we do have now that we can work on to intervene. So our supply chain, every piece of equipment we use takes energy to produce, transport, and dispose of. Then our scanners and facilities themselves are huge energy hogs. And finally, there's the energy it takes for patient and staff travel and transport. Okay, so starting with our supply chain, what can we do? Well, it may not come as a surprise to anybody that single-use devices are very wasteful, right? In IR, actually, one study found that 41% of their carbon emissions came from the production and disposal of single-use devices. So we can work to find ways where we can use more reusable devices. But even before we do that, this picture shows the packaging waste from one neurointerventional procedure. And that's about 55% of single-use device weight by volume is packaging. So we can work with our vendors and suppliers to decrease this packaging without even impacting how our devices work. And then next, when we think about capital equipment, we have a good solution too. It takes a ton of energy to produce a CT scanner, right? So almost the same amount of energy as 400 US households use in a year. But refurbished equipment is the same quality equipment at a lower cost, and both a lower financial and a lower environmental cost. Okay, so next I want to talk a little bit about how we can decrease our energy use. And so one obvious and very effective solution is going to be to switch to renewables, whether that's at a hospital or a statewide level. And this is a study that looked at carbon emissions per modality in different states. So for reference, this is the average carbon emissions from an MR scan, the US national average. Then this is the emissions for an abdominal MR in Indiana, a state that's grid uses a ton of coal. And here we have the emissions for the state of Washington, where they have a lot of hydropower. So you can see how this effectively can bring down our emissions quite a bit. But let's say your system is not interested in sourcing from renewable energy. Well, we can also work to increase the energy efficiency of our scanners. So this is an idealized graphic of CT scanner energy use in an outpatient setting throughout the day. These peaks here represent when we are scanning, but I want to focus on the ends of the bar. So what are our options after hours and on weekends? And you can leave your scanner in an idle state, like it's ready to scan immediately. You can put it into a low power mode, or you can put it into an off setting. And one study found that by putting their study into low power, their scanners into low power mode on nights and weekends, they could save about 1,400 kilowatt hours of savings. So just to give you some context, that's about the same amount of energy that two US households use in a year, and it saved them about $2,000 per scanner. So I know at our institution, we put some of our outpatient scanners into a low power mode. We've looked into putting them into an off mode, but here it can take an hour or two for the scanner to start up again, and our engineers have concerns about how that might damage the tube. So here's an opportunity where we need to start working with vendors and asking them to design a way where we have these efficiency modes built in, so it's not a user thing, and it's not in the control of us to have to sort of decide whether to turn it on and off, and it just happens automatically. Okay, so I want to switch to how we can heat and cool our facilities and what kind of energy efficiency savings we have there. So here again, we're looking at interventional radiology, and this figure shows different sources of emissions for an interventional radiology suite. The number one source of emissions was our climate control system, or the energy it took to heat and cool the system. And you can see this is divided into light blue and gray bars. So the gray bar shows the energy used to heat and cool the suite after hours, so when it was unoccupied by a patient. And here we have some options to increase our efficiency too. And just for some, for an additional note, diagnostic radiology, it also takes a ton of energy to cool our scanners, so this is applicable there too. So options we have in terms of change. Where possible, we can advocate for higher efficiency systems in new construction and renovations. But we also can reduce air exchanges after hours in our interventional suites. So what does that mean? During the day and when a patient is in the room, the air in the room has to be exchanged a certain number of times for infection prevention, but we don't have to do that after hours. And hospital systems have been implementing this. For example, the Cleveland Clinic has saved over $1 million annually in their operating rooms doing this. Okay, so lastly, I just want to talk a little bit about patient and staff travel and transport. Here we don't have as much data specific to radiology, but when we look at the healthcare system or other specialties, we see that this is a large impact of care. So what are some things we can do to address this? Well, one obvious solution for us is implementing teleradiology where feasible. But we can also optimize scheduling so that patients don't have to take multiple trips to the healthcare center. And then I know we saw that mobile imaging van earlier. And I think that, you know, there are creative solutions out there that we can look to where we can increase access and maybe decrease patient travel. Imagine like an electric mobile imaging van. Okay, so I want to thank you guys so much right? As I mentioned earlier, we're at a pretty critical moment in human history in terms of our climate actions. But paradoxically, we're also at the edge of a clean energy revolution, right? We have the technology, it's on the horizon, it's becoming more cost effective. We just need to push it in that direction. And I hope that all of you will join me in trying to do this in healthcare. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Schoen. And last before our discussion will be Dr. Waite.
Hi, it's my pleasure to talk to you today. My name is Steve Waite from SUNY Downstate in Brooklyn, New York. I work at a safety net hospital, and about 95, I looked into this maybe 6 years ago, 95 plus percent of our patients are African American or Afro Caribbean. So it's very much a safety net hospital, underserved community. So I'm gonna talk to you for the next 50 minutes about some practical steps to improve health equity. And the impetus for this talk for me came from reading and listening to dozens of lectures and reading a lot of excellent papers over the last couple of years about DI initiatives and disparities, where authors discuss things such as forming committees, task force, and mission statements. And one of these papers had eight authors on the paper to me, and it occurred to me that I barely have maybe 10 radiologists in my entire department at SUNY Downstate proper. So needless to say, most of those people are not involved in equity initiatives. So what can those of us working in less well-funded, small departments do, maybe individuals do, to reduce disparities in our backyards? Hopefully I can provide some thoughts on that regard. I have no financial disclosures. So what are the disparities that are constantly discussed? Well, to me, this slide says it all. The life expectancy for blacks in 2019 is about 75 years old, and white Americans was 79 years old. And COVID hasn't done anybody any favors. You can see the precipitous decline in mortality, especially among blacks and Native Americans. So we know the healthcare disparities run the gamut from higher infant mortality to worse cancer outcomes. And the etiology disparities, as stated before my excellent colleagues, originate from poverty, poor schools, toxic environments, so-called social determinant health, as well as provider intrinsic and extrinsic biases and poor quality health. So one thing I thought useful to understand, it took me a while to understand this, maybe I'm a little slow, is the terminology itself is not always clear. People talk about DI. What does that mean? Well, I talked to a lot of my colleagues and they in this space, like Dr. Janelle Scott, who's at RSNA, one of the RSNA chair people, committee members, that is. DI is really at the level of the workplace. So when they talk about DI in institutions, they're talking about diversity, equity, inclusion in a work environment. And in medicine, the presumption, as stated before, was that diversity and equity and inclusion will foster decreased health disparities and thereby promote equity. When they talk about health equity proper, it's sort of the ultimate goal of healthcare, and what we're talking about is at the level of the population. The definition, at least as far as the CDC, is equity in healthcare is when every person has the opportunity to attain their full potential health. No one disadvantaged from attaining this potential due to race, ethnicity, age, gender, disability, sexual orientation, nationality, socioeconomic status, or geographical background. So I thought that's important to understand. Why I always try to come back when I talk about this stuff is, well, what does that do with radiology? We read films, right? Well, all of us have seen graphs like this. They talk about breast cancer incidence, the rate of new cases are lower among black than white women. However, mortality is higher in blacks, up to 39% from 2014-2018. Well, what I found interesting is this wasn't all, I never looked at the back part of graph, and it wasn't always this way. So what exactly happened? Well, New England Journal of Medicine did a study in 2022, and they said, widespread use of screening mammography and adjuvant systemic therapy beginning in the 1980s was a critical turning point, led to substantial overall reduction in breast cancer mortality. However, it also led to large racial disparities in breast cancer mortality. And black women have derived less benefit from these interventions than white women. So radiology is a front and center role in disparities, and Dr. Kagetsu mentioned right away, is no longer theoretical. Effective January 1st this year, Joint Commission now has requirements to reduce healthcare disparities with health equity components part of its accreditation requirements for healthcare organizations. So radiologists, we can increase our sort of profile in the hospital by working with hospitals to fulfill these requirements. Well, so what can an individual do? So I thought about this a lot and came up with three sort of main methods, as you call that a small group or individual can do to sort of move the needle. I would put them into advocacy, research, and workplace diversity. So I'm going to talk mostly about advocacy from the remainder of my talk, for lack of time. But it's important to understand that if you're inclined to research, you can get involved in artificial intelligence anti-bias methodology. In addition, it's been suggested that physicians may apply different criteria in recommending procedures for Black versus white patients, secondary bias, lack of access, or lack of knowledge. And there has been some studies show that evidence-based guidelines may reduce these disparities. In regards to improving the sort of dismal amounts of underrepresented minorities in radiology, radiologists can become what is called an ally, which is like a mentor or a sponsor, and not only play a role in development of a young medical student or a resident faculty member, but also decrease what is perhaps poorly called microaggressions. The reason it's actually defined as microaggression, not because it's small, it's because it's common and frequent. And I used to think in my ignorance that it wasn't a big deal until I saw it happen a lot, actually. So to me, I would argue that in order to be an effective advocate, one of the prerequisites is a strong knowledge base about the nature and reality of disparities. And I believe step one in addressing a problem is acknowledging a problem exists in the first place. And the studies that have been done demonstrate the general population doesn't really acknowledge healthcare disparities exist. A study by the Kaiser Family Foundation 2006 found that 24% of whites and 55% of blacks believe blacks get lower quality care than whites, although many studies have shown different levels of access, quality, technology, expertise, and outcomes, even in the same network. 2007, Dr. Siegel et al. Did a study with interviews of senior health system executives, and they basically said disparities in healthcare are not an organizational priority for U.S. hospitals. And what he called assumed equity. Providers assume they provide equal care to various groups they service, but never test this assumption. So maybe doctors are better, right? So 2002, the American College of Cardiology looked at a meta-analysis of 21 peer-reviewed studies, and they concluded there was strong evidence for racial disparity in use of diagnostic cardiac procedures, revascularization, thrombolytic therapy, other cardiac drug therapies, procedures, and treatments. However, a survey of cardiologists in 2004 showed that cardiologists don't know this exists. Only 34% of cardiologists agreed there were disparities in care overall in the U.S. healthcare system, and only 5% thought they existed among their own patients. Women doctors, black doctors, and doctors with large numbers of minority patients were more likely to report the disparities exist. And it's maybe old data, right? 2016, another study, surgeons basically showed no difference. 37% agree that ethnic disparities exist in healthcare. Only 4.7 reported that exists within their own personal practice. So the conclusion is that doctors are largely unaware disparities exist in medicine, and if so, not in my backyard. It doesn't happen in my institution and certainly not in my practice. The problem with this, obviously, is that there was actually a study with residents showed that increased knowledge regarding that healthcare disparities exist has been found to be associated with greater recognition of disparities as important, which in turn is related to increased conversation with patients about their barriers to care. I stole this slide from Efren. I don't know how he gets these beautiful slides, but so-called socio-ecological model for radiology barriers, which basically shows that radiology barriers are not simply at the level of the patient, but the level of the provider, community, and overall system. For example, in regards to women's imaging, organ providers that take care of a lot of minorities may not be aware of the latest criteria for advanced imaging such as breast MRI. When a study is performed, who's reading it? Is it a mammographer or a general radiologist? How do they communicate results to patients? What about at-risk populations? What's reimbursement? Without naming names, I know a very large public healthcare system where only one of the hospitals in the network will do MRI-guided biopsies. Some of the hospitals do MRI without biopsies, so there's a very real access problem that exists. In the ACR bulletin, Efren and Dr. Chonde could talk about this more than I can, I'm sure. And this year, January, said the Mass General has a pink slip program where rather than just label patients as non-compliant, They make it easier for women to access care, which I think is quite brilliant, quite frankly. Women who can get on-site breast imaging, go to on-site breast imaging center after their primary care visits. This acknowledges that a lot of at-risk patients have hourly jobs, childcare priority, and who use this system? Black, Asian patients, patients on Medicare, patients with English as the second language, and they found increased screening compliance. And that goes along with the mobile lung cancer screening, the RiseShare program that was talked about earlier. So with this knowledge, I believe radiologists can become an advocate for capital assets, equipment, and services to reduce health equities. The nature of the problem is such that Dr. Colwell did a study, 206 meta-analysis, 206 studies, 72% found decreased or inappropriate imaging in minority groups, lower rates of PET-CT use, lower rates of imaging for abdominal pain in the ED, services such as lung cancer screening in states with highest proportion of blacks is lowest, actually. And this sort of technology for us is problematic because the principle is that higher technology procedures often increase accuracy for medical conditions compared with lower technology counterparts, which is why, you know, go to ARRS every year, they talk about their newest, greatest imaging equipment. So what are some of these structural disparities? Well, there aren't that many studies directly talking about this as you might think, but, and I know this for a fact working at Downstate, is racial ethnic minorities are less likely to use what they call high technology hospitals. They're less likely to go to academic medical centers. White patients are 3 times more likely to be hospitalized at academic medical center than a black patient. And one study out of New York said that Medicaid patients less than half as likely to compare with privately insured patients. Their conclusion was New York City's hospitals remain highly segregated by race, ethnicity, and insurance. There's massive inequality. One study that was very well done by Himmelstein found inequities in the hospital's physical resources. That's hospitals serving people of color, more than 23% of black patients, they call the hospitals serving people of color, had markedly lower capital assets, less new asset purchases, and are less likely to offer specific capital-intensive services than hospitals that don't take care of as many black patients. The even in-network care differences. In a recent study, Christian looked at 5% sample of Medicare insurance claims data 2005-2020. Amongst many other findings, they found that at the same institutions, blacks were 16% less likely to receive digital breast tomosynthesis. And this disparity persisted by the end of 2020, and I read some more recent studies that say it persists to this day. This is a paper with the same insurance, the same network, demonstrating, again, that minority patients are often the last to benefit from newer medical technologies, what they call technological diffusion. So in addition to advocating for capital equipment, radiologists can and should advocate for expanded services, like I was talking about earlier, lung cancer screening, cardiac imaging, advanced breast imaging technologies. A recent study, a recent paper, the report, American Lung Associates 2022, showed that only 5.8% of those eligible in 2021 for lung cancer screening with low-dose CT were screened. And in California and Nevada, screening rates were as 1 and 1.3% respectively, and the best state was Massachusetts at 16%. Why is this a problem? Well, survival rate, we know that lung cancer diagnosed late stages is less likely curable. Nationally, only 26% of cases diagnosed at early stage, when 5-year survival rate is 61%. More than that, 44% of cases are not called to early stage, when survival rate is only 7%. And they found, again, people of color were diagnosed with lung cancer faced worse outcomes compared to white Americans, with lower survival rates, less likely to be diagnosed early, less likely to receive surgical treatment, and more likely to receive no treatment at all. As compounding the poor rates in lung cancer screening in general, blacks are even less participatory. Even in a program, they may only get just one scan. So eligible black patients are less likely to be screened. And Lamidal in 2020, in meta-analysis, found that they have non-adherence to follow-up scans once even when in a lung cancer screening program. That is, they get one screen exam and they don't come back anymore. Why is that a problem? Because over 50% of lung cancers were detected in the NLST and Nelson trials on follow-up screening rounds. Racial minorities and patients without post-secondary education are more non-adherent. And advocating for a program navigator and coordinator may reduce this non-adherence. I and Dr. Chonde mentioned this earlier. I found myself in these financial discussions, which aren't usually the sort of purview of radiologists, but some, when you deal with a safety in a hospital, they're very concerned about the bottom lines, how these programs will be profitable. So I thought this was an interesting study. The cost of treating lung cancer increased with advanced age up to $250,000 last year life. Screening can increase detection early stages when intervention is more economical and leads to additional procedures and downstream revenue. A study by Chung et al. In 2019, they did a free lung cancer screening CTs, 705 scans in Southeastern United States centered in Augusta, Georgia, an indigent population with a median household income was 27% lower than national average, and the poverty level was 65% higher. And they found increased surgical intervention for operable lung cancer, 74% were early stage, referred specialists, surgical oncology, internal medicine, cardiology, the first year of the program. New patients were introduced into the system for other health care services, and they found profitability from downstream revenue, free scans with lag time of 2 years in a poor population. So in summary, I would say to advocacy is a good way to, you know, to reduce healthcare disparities, educate yourself and others, advocate for equipment services. Radiologists can actually participate in the financial justification, and it actually can help hospitals TUFER fulfill Joint Commission requirements and promote equity at the same time. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you. So it seems we have no online questions, so let's, any questions from the audience? Otherwise, we're gonna have to quiz each other.
Thank you all so much for these phenomenal presentations. I learned so much this morning, and each of you did such a great job. Thank you so much. I have a question for Dr. Khosa for research. So how can we operationalize the collection of the racial data? Is that something easy to do? Why is it not already being done, or is it being done and people are reluctant in filling in that information? Do folks understand why they're being asked, what race they represent when it's a research involvement?
So thank you so much. There is a philosophical answer and there is an academic answer. Let me start with the philosophical answer. You know, wherever I have seen persisting inefficiency in any system, not just medicine, it was because somebody was benefiting from it. So the reason the racial data is not collected is because some demographic benefits from it and says, well, we can't do anything about it because we don't have the data. Collection of the data, you know, if you, there's a difference between a boundary and a barrier. This is a barrier. If you don't accept a barrier as a boundary, you will overcome it, you will remove it or eliminate it. And that is what we all need to do. That if data is collected about, do you have the insurance or not? Collected, right? Is it Blue Cross, Blue Shield, or is it Harvard, or is it whatever, right? If that data can be collected and is valuable or valued, because it's reimbursement related, how come data on race is any less important? So what we have to do is, we've got to keep knocking on that door till it opens. And that is how we were discussing that we all at our own institutions have brought about change that was thought of an elusive dream. We all have realized some dreams, and there are many more that we can realize. And also important is we cross-pollinate, we learn from each other's successes so we can replicate it, and learn from each other's mistakes so that we don't duplicate it. I hope I've answered the question. Thank you so much.
You know, I have a question on that same vein. I find that at my institution, whenever I'm trying to push the boundaries on data collection of race and gender, most specifically, you know, advocating for the creation of Middle Eastern North African as an option, a lot of people say, oh, well, you know, it's not in the US Census, it's not collected there, therefore we shouldn't add it. Well, how do you feel about that? Should we be collecting more detailed data on race and ethnicity, or should we just limit ourselves to what is considered the standard of care?
Well, if we stick with the standard of care, then we would, you know, Henry Ford, the guy who invented the Ford car, he said, if I had asked my audience what you want next, or what you would like next, he said the unanimous answer would have been a faster horse. So he said, I did not listen to them and I did not ask them. And that is why you have the Ford Mustang, right? So if he can do it in that automotive industry over 100 years ago, maybe we need to learn some lessons from that. And that is an example I would quote and you can quote. And there are many similar examples from outside medicine that we need to embrace and quote. That's the problem, you know, we are so tunnel vision in medicine, unfortunately. But there are so many examples, as I said, you know, automotive industry and car accidents from that sanitizer, right? Mm-hmm. And all these are, nobody can deny that, correct? And those are the examples we need to quote. But I absolutely agree. The more information you have, the better it is. Why should race be any different? Mm-hmm. It's not, right? It shouldn't be. And again, don't accept a barrier as a boundary. But thank you. Very valuable question. Thank you.
Yeah. I think that's a great question. I think folks are working on, you know, what should be a standard race and ethnicity kind of model to aspire for, or some sort of standardization, if you will. But yeah, the MENA category is definitely on up there for debate. One question I had for you all that do the rideshare. I know in New York City there were some private practices that were saying, oh, well, you know, use our private practice, we'll pick up your patient. And it was in some ways their personal interest to have their patients, and clinicians liked it. But I thought there were some laws that you probably should check with legal, perhaps you checked with legal, and whether it falls under kickback. Faisal and I were just saying no good deed goes unpunished, right? And so you might have wonderful intentions, but some folks may see, you know, you should probably double check with legal before you just go out and start doing it.
Yeah, of course. And there's also certain limitations to what legal, like Faisal was saying, right? You know, when there's ulterior motives in there, of course it's easiest for the hospital not to have any additional risk by just saying, like, we can't have ride shares. But when you look at it as a transportation issue, of course it makes sense, right? If you have patients who can't get there, having ride shares reduces that barrier. So there is an indication that it is useful. Now, many hospitals have taxi programs, right, where, you know, many EDs where they will, if a patient can't make their way home, you can get them a taxi voucher. And then there, if you can have a taxi voucher, that is essentially the same thing as a ride share. Now, granted, there's things like Lyft and Uber, which are very commercial ride share programs, but there are also some more medically focused ride share programs. And I think that's what we used at Mass General.
You wanted to, can I add to that real briefly? Yeah, sure, thanks.
To the point of, you're absolutely correct in terms of checking with general Office of General Counsel or institutional lawyer, and the reason why we have to do that because there's a fear of inducement, patient inducement. That's the main concern, and one of the reasons why. So we've been trying to establish this program for years, and one of the main barriers or hurdles that we had to overcome was making sure that this was not problematic from that patient inducement perspective, and from getting the okay or the green light from legal. And the way that one of the reasons why we don't openly advertise this, and the reason how we got started was to, when patients spontaneously said that they needed to cancel their appointment because of a transportation difficulty, then we offered the service at that moment. And then, but now the state has provided some additional leeway to assist patients with
predetermined need for transportation, so though that have so non-emergent medical transportation, which would the rideshare would fall under. For example, people in wheelchair that are dependent on official modes of transportation, you're going to offer this proactively, so to ensure that they can receive the care they need.
I would say there's a wonderful intersection between health equity and the quality space. And I believe I first met Efren at a quality ACR quality safety meeting in Denver, and that meeting they were talking about turnaround time and waiting time for mammography results, and instead of measuring those in days for turnaround time, they should call it sleepless nights. And if it's your loved one and you're waiting for a potentially life-changing result, it could be sleepless nights. And there's other folks, perhaps if we have another version of this session, they were looking at the whole workflow from the time you get mammography, who do you report it to, and then by the time they actually get their biopsy, they realize that, you know, from mammography, they would tell the general practice person that would invariably refer to them to a surgeon. They would just say, cut out the middle person, just mammography, and then get the surgical referral and get the biopsy. And, you know, it all goes in that category of doing well and doing good, right? We do good, but we also actually increase the profitability of the whole chain. But yeah, that could be maybe next year. I'm sorry, one more question.
All these questions, Dr. Flores, you showed these very nice pictures of you out there in the community, connecting, talking about your research, recruiting, helping people along. Is this just a one-time, your personal initiative, or is this something that your institution will adopt or is adopting or is doing?
I'll have to say that, well, first, and that phase probably Dr. Dan Chonde can speak more with the incredible initiative that he's doing through the People's Heart, and I invite everybody that is here and those who are virtually to visit, because in terms of not only infusing art into our healthcare spaces, but also healing structural racism through the power of art. I think it is such a unique initiative, and I give a lot of kudos to Dan for leading that effort. I have to say that for the institutional level, so first, it's not a one-off. That community engagement really requires the longitudinal engagement. There are many colleagues that are involved, not only in, for example, there in that photo that I show, myself, Mark Sushi, and next to me was Dr. Gladys Pacha, who like a psychiatrist at MGH. We have other, in the Puerto Rican festival, we have physicians from internal medicine, primary care, and other specialty. So it shows that there's an institutional commitment to that, because really in this space, we need many helping hands. It definitely cannot do it alone. And really for us to build something that is sustainable, we have to help each other. Because the work is not easy, but I said a heavy lift is not easy if you're doing alone. So if you do it with many people, it becomes easier for everybody. And I'm not saying that it's a task that we don't have to do, but lifting something heavy can be done with many of us together. And the same thing for health equity. Not that it's a heavy lift, but it's something that is needed and we have to do it together. And that engagement, so I remember the first time one of the events I went there, I met everybody. And I was just talking with the people. And then the next time I went to another event, unrelated to a specific project, just they had an event, they invited me and others, and we participated that. And then the third time, it just becomes more like we're just chatting, like, you know, we know each other. So there's an understanding of I'm not in it to do my project and go. I'm here to stay. And the same thing for everybody that participates continually. And Dr. Chandler can speak more about that community engagement, because he's done incredible work in this space.
And you know, I guess to finish your question specifically, you know, our hospital does not specifically give us time or kind of build this into our work schedule to allow for community engagement. However, there are institutions out there now that are recognizing that this is really an interesting opportunity to reduce burnout by providing opportunities for you know, community engagement in many forms, be it volunteering, being working on, you know, kind of promoting hospital initiatives that go out into the community. So there's definitely space for many of our healthcare systems to kind of engage further and increase that, both for physicians and non-physicians. As far as the art thing, that really came out of a research interest, or I guess more of a equity interest in how to create spaces that were more inclusive. And I was able to build that into a research interest. And then as part of a research interest, I'm allowed to kind of bill research time as community engagement time. And you know, this hopefully at some point institutions recognize that when you have doctors who are going to the Puerto Rican Festival, right, who are making an appearance in Nubian Square at Honk Festival, which is a music festival in a predominantly black portion of Boston, when they're out there connecting with patients on an equal level, that that builds a relationship both between the hospital and the patients, but also the patient and the individual provider, which then can, you know, benefit with bringing these patients who are reticent to come into or engage with our healthcare systems to engage with us, and, you know, specifically engage with our individual healthcare systems, and then be secondary promoters to their friends and families.
Yeah, I wanted to briefly add that I have to say that some of the best research questions have come up from the community engagement events, like your conversations with the community, because they give you such a different perspective. And they have the finger on the pulse of what is happening. And then it provides me an opportunity to look at things from a from their different perspective. So then I'm not thinking about way of things from that perspective, and then research question for either publication, it could be a grant, or it could be like a new community outreach initiative. Definitely come infused from those conversations, for sure. Definitely I gain a lot more from the community engagement that what I can give, and then also the satisfaction of that what you do matters. Process. I know that we talk about always about no margin, no mission. That's the perspective from the institution, but like there's no price tag that you can put to the having that genuine connection with people.
So one thing that perhaps is semi-related. I know. One of our residents through CIR, the union, they offered very easy ways for the resident to, you know, just go to a local school and say what it's like to be a doctor, and just it kind of does the pipeline, that whole pipeline thing, and underserved or in the community. And perhaps this could be another idea for another session, Community Engagement 101. And I know Efren was involved in, perhaps you can give us a summary of your RSNA, not to pit societies against each other, but RSNA had community engagement in Chicago, and it could have, and we kind of did, well, we had an opening session from the community, but it would be cool to, and Dan, I think, is working on something maybe for Boston, but it would be cool to just see, you know, the engagement, and then that would kind of help again with the image, oh, radiologists don't see patients, like, what about this? And you can say, not only patients, we actually are doing impactful things to address, mitigate health disparities. So I think it's very cool. And I think we have a big role, whether it's lung cancer screening and all other screenings we may do, breast cancer. And then, you know, and just amongst friends, you know, healthcare disparities, we did say several times, race is a social construct, but unless it isn't, right? And so some people are even talking about maybe the breast cancer screening rules should be different for African-Americans, African-American women, because, you know, what we have to do something to catch it earlier or you know, maybe, and that's where the research comes in, and we'll have perhaps evidence-based decision-making. I see a question.
Hi, I'm Faz. I just have a comment. Thank you, everyone, for your talks. And I really am an advocate for community involvement, and as a pediatric interventional radiologist, I I ask myself, how can we engage our patients more and into decreasing the, these healthcare disparities? And one way that I think is at the fundamental, at the base of these healthcare disparities is education, and especially our own education as physicians with regard to nutrition and healthy nutrition, and how can we share with our patients, our communities, the importance of eating a whole foods based diet. And I'm an advocate of whole foods, plant-based diet. And I'd love to hear, and it also, you know, touches on the climate change is, you know, practicing a whole foods, plant-based diet is better for the environment, better for our nutrition, and better for our, for everything. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, so I have this luxury of being able to just be very dynamic and dexterous in this art space with this arts program. So what we end up doing is we will have like mini conferences based around certain things. We had one last year on health equity in Native America. And what we did was we ended up, you know, working with some local businesses to kind of raise some money. And we were able to bring a lecturer named Sean Sherman, who calls himself the Sioux Chef, S-I-O-U-X, because he is Sioux. And he his organization works on Native American food system resiliency. Because obviously when you think about Native American reservations, take the Navajo reservation, for instance, it's 28,000 miles or 1,000 square miles, right? Huge space. They have 13 grocery stores. In that setting, what you need to do when you have grocery stores and such a spread out population, when the population has limitations on how they can actually get to those spaces, you focus on things that have long shelf life. Similarly, when we started the Native American reservation system back in like 1800s, 1900s, right? They also started the food commodities, I think it was Food Commodities Association, or it was part of the government. And essentially what they did was they pushed things that were outside of the traditional Native American diets, things that had long shelf life, talking about vegetable shortening, talking about canned foods, highly processed foods, things that today many of us would look at and be like, not very nutritional, right? But because they were long shelf life and they provided calories at the time, they were good enough, right? And so what we now need to do is we now need to look at how this translated over time, right? Higher, like saturated or unhealthy fats in foods led to higher incidences of diabetes, which led to higher mortality from diabetes because of barriers to healthcare. So as what we, so one of the benefits that we have now is, you know, whatever institution you're at, there are going to be local businesses, there's going to be a mayor's office, they're going to have an organization for arts and councils, and you can ask, or arts and culture, you can ask them for funding. And what you can do is you can bring in some of these nutrition speakers to create online videos or show up to in-person events in the community. I think to get Sean Sherman, who is now one of Time's top 100 people, you know, it cost us like $4,000 or something. Don't quote me on that because I could be slightly wrong, but it was like in that range. It wasn't getting like Ibram Kendi where you're paying $80,000 for him to speak for an hour or two. These people are very approachable and they understand the important underpinning of this work, of kind of advocating for healthy eating in communities. So, you know, always try to make it an arts and equity move, and then you find that those doors open up really quickly. And then it's similarly, there's a clear climate benefit to it, so.
Yeah, no, and I think that, you know, in some ways we miss an opportunity in healthcare. Like, I'm a vegetarian and there are so many limited options in our health, in our cafeteria to
eat a plant-based diet. And this is an opportunity where we can display to our patients, like, hey, not only is this food nutritious, but it can be delicious, right? I'm in North Carolina where we have tons of amazing fresh grown produce around, and we can support local businesses. So I think that's a place we can start as well. And many hospitals are moving in this direction. So Health and Human Services has a climate pledge for hospitals to reduce their carbon footprint by 50% by 2030. And as part of this, there are many hospitals that are looking at their food systems and ways that they can source more sustainable, more plant-based diets, and more local food. So if your hospital is a part of that, that's awesome, and you can advocate for more plant-based diets and nutritious food as part of that. And if it's not, you can advocate for them to join it.
Okay. Dr. Kato.
Time, but for Dr. Waite, I have a question. You brought up this very interesting observation that we do have diversity, equity, and inclusion that we talk about in the context of the work environment and making sure everybody is included and, you know, treated equity, all of that. But then there's health equity, and even though the word equity is in both of these, it's something completely different. And so we used to have a vice chair for diversity, equity, and inclusion, and pretty much the focus was on the workforce and education and diversification. But where should the health equity piece live? Because in the quality improvement work, which is my background, we also focus on patient-centered care, and equity, health equity is a part of that. But if we want to emphasize it, how do you recommend that? Let's say you're in an academic institution, how should a department chair make sure that that area is really being addressed and progress is made?
Kind of had to think about the answer to that question. The reason I had that slide is because I constantly heard the term DEI, and I couldn't really understand the difference between that and when they talk about health equity. And so the sort of, just to make sure I understand the nature of the question, you're asking where should health equity fall as far as DEI? What do you?
Yeah, in the radiology department, who should be in charge of?
Oh, people have done some studies on that, and pretty much supposedly the leadership is supposed to make, you know, the question actually is, and I had slides about this, but just simply no time to talk about it, what does the DEI of DEI stand for in the first place? And diversity is supposed to be have different groups of people represented, not even necessarily physical traits, just like mindset, like people of different sort of, like maybe somebody who's more involved in arts than I might be. Equity is supposed to be the opportunity of people to all be able to achieve some sort of standard level. And inclusion is, that's the tricky one. Inclusion actually is supposed to be that people's voices all heard. And there's some very clever papers where people talk about stories about what happens if you have the diversity and equity but no inclusion, or if you have inclusion but no diversity and equity, and I don't have time to talk about that. But it's very interesting sort of things. But
you
yeah, the leadership
of
the department.
You have 8 minutes to talk. Go, do it.
No, well, I have to go to my slide, and I can actually unhide the slides, and I can actually go through that, actually. But it's really the responsibility of the chairman, the leadership, to be able to. One of the things my colleague of mine at Cornell actually told me that if you want to be the diversity, you know, all these institutions have diversity chiefs or, you know, departments and things like this. And it's not just the box, it shouldn't be just a box check exercise. And she said that I didn't think of it this way. She's like, well, you should be involved with, for example, the SNMA, the Student National Medical Association, the Latino organization. You should be involved in not just recruiting faculty that are diverse, but promoting them. And if their graphs, which, again, I had a much longer presentation about, the percentage of minority, you know, instructors and assistant associate professors continually declines over time, and there's very, very, very few. Maybe 3%, I think, of radiology workforce is considered African American. It's very, very low. So if you want to be involved in diversity workspace, it encompasses much more than simply trying to, you know, put some pictures on the wall and say we have diversity. Do you guys have any thoughts about this?
Yeah, so there is a difference between looking good and feeling good, right? Can somebody complete this sentence for me? Fish rots at the? Fish rots at the top. So it all falls on leadership.
Mm.
And so an organization or an institution will never function above the level of its leader.
Right.
You look at Google, right? We were talking about transportation earlier. What does Google do? Google actually asks the employees to bring their kids to work. Then there are child cares at work, or buses take their children to school, pick and drop. How come no hospital has ever been ranked the top place to work or as profitable as Google? Why? They do very simple things that in our minds we convolute and never approach. So it has to be the leadership's responsibility. As my friend said, it's checking the boxes currently. So you put somebody in a position of influence or decision making, and then you do not give them the resources and funding and authority, which means you're setting somebody up for failure. I can go on, but there's a question.
Thank you guys for your presentations. I think this isn't something that people think about on a daily basis, and I think it's been really interesting to listen to everybody's talks. One question I had for anybody is, you know, it seems to me that some places have more resources to be able to work on some of the solutions that you guys have mentioned. My question is, how do we take like what's being done solution-wise and implement them in areas that may not have had these opportunities, and where it sounds like these are places where we have like the highest health disparities? That'd be one question I had. And then my second question is, how do we improve buy-in, like from everybody, like patients, organizations, hospitals throughout the country? Thoughts on that would be appreciated.
I'll let Dr. Waite do part one.
Well, I was wanted to do part two, actually.
You can do part two.
I thought that was easier. Huh. No, because it goes to what Dr. Chonde and Efren talked about, which is margin and mission. I work at safety in the house, but I realized that they're so concerned about the bottom line, they don't have resources to spare. So you really have to involve yourself as much as possible in sort of financial discussions and how this can be profitable. It doesn't have to be hospitals, they're not charity organizations. So a lot of administrators want to see the bottom line. And I think some of the ideas that show them that it can make money over the long term, I think goes a long way. And we could be involved in these kind of discussions. Go ahead.
And I would say a lot of the errors regarding making things that can easily be transported to outside of our institution or more resource-limited institutions, that's all on us. We are terrible at that. We're terrible at it from a hospital standpoint all the way up to a society standpoint. When we're submitting a grant from Mass General Hospital, right, we can throw in all of these big name people that when they look at this grant, they know that there is a tradition of excellence coming out of there, right? And that looks like a really strong grant. What we should be doing is we should be increasing the value of inter-hospital or interstate collaboration, right? It doesn't really make sense from an equity standpoint for certain hospitals to be able to put forth these grants and say, this is what we want to do in our small area and limit it to our area, while there are other hospitals that might be in situations where they are much more resource limited and could do much more interesting things with that money, but don't necessarily have the big name and the fancy logo. So, you know, we just all need to do so much better.
That means Efren's going to collaborate with Boston University. Next project.
Kentucky.
Yeah, so I'm just going to speak specifically to the topic of climate action, although I'm sure there's overlap. I think that what everyone has said is true, that financial resources are a huge motivation. Personally, I hate the phrase, someone needs to keep the lights on, right? We need to start turning the lights off. I think what I've found critically important is listening to the person you're trying to convince so that you can find their values, right? And often that is going to be financial, but sometimes there are different motivations, whether it's, you know, someone has kids or someone loves fishing or, you know, all sorts of different people, reasons that people might have motivations to engage with climate action. And often I find too that when people see that you sort of share their values and connections, they're much more amenable to talking about change.
Also, one thing that does not cost at all is we support each other as minorities. We learn from each other. We have a dialogue rather than monologue. As I said earlier, learn from each other's successes so we can duplicate it, and learn from each other's failures so that we avoid them. So the thing that costs nothing is connecting with each other, learning from each other, bringing opportunities to each other, promoting, sponsoring each other.
Just wanted to briefly add, so we have 20 seconds, that two things that we typically have as a centripetal approach, where things come from the academic medical center and disseminate to the community, but then we encounter the barriers in implementation because the resources are not the same. So we try to change that paradigm into thinking about more like really a community center approach, where the community becomes a model of how we should be delivering care at the academic medical center. But there's also increased awareness from national organizations. So Stephen talked about joint commission showing that a requirement for health disparities, CMS is coming. So just a matter of time, our payment model was going to start reflecting the need to do this work. So that conversation, you can start having a conversation with your key stakeholders to say there's a need for this in terms of organizational readiness to approach this, because that time is coming. So the other thing that, you know, one of the conversations with somebody in finance and leadership in finance, he was saying when we talk about the ROI and KPI and what, you know, what's the business argument for equity, you know, one of the things that he was saying during the conversation is that not all revenue is monetary. There's a reputational component as well for doing the right thing. So that it should be part of your formula when you're having those conversations. And then you bring a comprehensive approach, and I agree with what Julia was saying, finding alignment in what you're trying to achieve with what your institutional leader are trying to achieve, and find that common ground, and then you're going to find a lot of opportunities for growth.
I'd like to officially thank you, close the session, and I think we have time that we'll stop the recording, and then you're welcome to come up and say hi. I'm wearing my computer glasses. I can't even see you, so just come up and say hi, and I can actually see you. But thank you for the panelists for a great job, and thank you to Rink and Ray for allowing us to do this. And thank you all for being with us for 2 hours. So thank you.